Hello, welcome to the second lecture of the Process Mining Summer School. In this lecture, we are going to focus on the foundations of process discovery. My name is Will van der Aalst. I'm a professor at RWTH Aachen University. I'm also the chief scientist of Solonis. In the previous lecture, we spoke about the different types of process mining. We have seen that there are very advanced forms of process mining, for example, combining process discovery later with machine learning, or automatically turning diagnostics into actions, or how to compare two different processes. However, since we are just at the beginning of the summer school, we are now focusing on the first task, and that is process discovery. This is, of course, all under the assumption that event data are there. And in the first lecture, I explained that this is not a trivial process, and there are also different types of event data one can extract. So for example, research is now heavily focusing on object-centric process mining, where we load event logs, where every event can refer to multiple object types. However, here we start with the very basics. So we assume that we have standard event data. We just look at the sequences of activities per case and use that as a starting point for discovery. Okay, so in this lecture, I'm going to first explain how to discover a directly follows graph. We will see that that is very easy. Then I will also tell a bit about how to filter a directly follows graph if it becomes too complicated or too spaghetti-like. And after this baseline discovery algorithm that has many limitations, we will turn to more sophisticated techniques, such as the alpha algorithm and inductive mining. The alpha algorithm is an example of bottom-up discovery. So we basically start with a process model where we just have activities, and then we try to add constraints to it in the form of places. So that's bottom-up. The inductive mining approach is more top-down. So we are trying to split our data into smaller data sets, and we use a kind of divide and conquer strategy. In this lecture, I will often also show the formal definitions that you can find in chapter 2, but for understanding the basics of these algorithms, I will try to add text in such a way that even if you have difficulties with the formalizations, you are still able to understand how these techniques work. Okay, let's get started. So first, what is the main idea of process discovery? As I mentioned earlier, event data can be very complicated. For example, in object-centric process mining, events may refer to multiple objects. So we have, for example, an event place order that is referring to an order, items that are in the order, a customer, etc., etc. But here we go very much to the basics, and every case is described by a sequence of activities. So we start with an event log that in mathematical terms can be described as a multi-set of traces. And every trace is a sequence of activity names, as you can see here. So in this small data set, there are 10 cases that follow the pattern A, B, C, E, where A, B, C, and E are abstract activity names. And there is, for example, just one case that follows the pattern ADE. So this is the basic idea. We have an event log where we have a multi-set of sequences of activities. And based on that, our goal is to discover process models. These can be directly follows graphs, these can be accepting Petri nets, or these can be process trees. And the pros and cons of these different representations we will see in a minute. So the goal of this lecture is to show you how you can turn such basic event data into process models that describe the data that we have seen. And of course, this is a super tiny example, and here it's kind of trivial what the process is like. But remember the examples that we have seen earlier. Often we need to deal with, let's say, thousands of different process variants. And it is not so easy to see what the underlying process is. So if we try to formalize it, and I already started a bit, so a trace is a sequence of activity names, and an event log is a multi-set of traces. From such an event log, we would like to discover a process model. So a discovery algorithm can be described as a function that turns a multi-set of traces into a process model. Yeah, so UM stands for the universe of process models. And given such a process model, it defines again a language, and the language of a model M is again a set of activities. So the input is a multi-set of activities, because the same sequence can appear multiple times, that is turned into a process model, and the process model has semantics, and the semantics are expressed in terms of the set of traces it can represent. And of course, there should be a relationship between the multi-set of traces that goes in and the set of traces that is in the end allowed by the process model. So let's take a look at an example. So here we have an event log L1 that consists of 16 cases, and 10 of the cases follow the pattern A, B, C, E, etc. So that's a multi-set of activities. Then we can, for example, generate such a process tree. We'll come back to the exact semantics later. And if you look at such a process tree, it allows for certain behaviors, and these behaviors are expressed as a set of traces. Yeah, so a set of sequences of activities. And in this case, you can see that if you ignore the frequencies, these two things are the same. That is not always the case, because we should bear in mind that the event log just contains examples. So we need to generalize, but in this super small example, that is not necessary. So here it is just coincidence that these two things are more or less the same if we ignore frequencies. Note that if you look at a process model, a standard process model, it only tells what traces are possible and what traces are not possible. It doesn't say anything about frequencies. Of course, when you replay the event log on top of such a model, you can add the frequencies, and that is already indicated here a bit using the numbers. Okay, so what are we going to do in this lecture? We first look at the baseline discovery approach that discovers the simplest of models, directly follows graphs. I already explained this, what this is in my first lecture. And then we look at two more sophisticated algorithms, the ELF algorithm, which is an example of bottom-up discovery, and inductive mining, which is an example of top-down discovery. And these are all three discovery techniques are instances of this function that I defined in definition tree. Okay, let's start with directly follows graphs. So here is the formal definition of a directly follows graph. And if I explain it in words, it's a graph where the nodes correspond to activities. And next to nodes corresponding to activities that we have seen in the log, there is a special start node and there is a special end node, indicated by the start symbol and the stop symbol. So the interpretation of a directly follows graph is that any instance of the process, any case, will start with this dummy start activity and ends with this dummy end activity. Yes, and if you look at the directly follows graph, you are basically considering all the paths in the graph that lead from start to end. And that's why it's important to add the start and end activities to clearly signal where the process begins and where the process ends. The arcs in such a directly follows graph correspond to directly follows relationship. So if an arc, if A is connected to B, that means from A, after executing A, it is possible to do B. The connection from B to E says that after doing B, it is possible to do E. So if you look at the directly following relation of A, after A, we can do B, C, or D, but we cannot do E. In a directly follows graph, because it's basically a visualization of the underlying data, we often show, let's say, numbers on arcs which correspond to frequencies. You can also add another type of numbering that it's indicating, let's say, how much time is being spent for going from A to B. And there you can think about the average time, variance, etc., etc. And so it's very important to see that one can view a directly follows graph not so much as a model, although we will interpret it as a model, but it's in a way a summary of the data, showing how often we have moved from one activity to another activity, and we are also indicating how often the individual activities took place. So if you look at such a directly follows graph and you look at the frequencies, you can see how often things have happened in the data. And so, for example, A has happened in total 16 times in our data set. D happened only once, and there was just one scenario where we were moving from A to D and from D to E. So this is basically a summary of the data, but you can also interpret this as a process model. And the process model describes all the traces that you get by taking an arbitrary path from beginning to end. Yeah, where the start and the end, we will not explicitly see that in our data, but we added that for clarity, that it's clear where the process starts and where the process ends. So based on this, we can create a trivial two-line discovery algorithm. We can simply say, okay, A, yeah, so that's our set of activities, excluding the artificial start and the artificial end. The set A is simply equal to all the activities that we see in any of the traces in the log. And we have arcs, and arcs are a multiset, and that is because we would like to keep track of how often we have moved from one activity to another activity. So what you see in this second line is that we first create an artificial log L prime, where we basically add the start and end to every trace that we have seen in the log. After doing that, we simply count how often we see one activity followed by the other activity. And note that sigma I and sigma I plus 1 are corresponding to two activities that are following each other in some trace sigma, and this trace sigma happens in the log. Note that these are multisets, yeah, so we always keep track of how often a certain trace has happened in the log, and of course we also keep track of how often one activity is followed by another activity. So it could be that activity A is followed by B in many different traces, but it's also possible that in the same trace A could be followed by B multiple times. So we add up all these, let's say, different directly follows relationships. So if you look at this data set, then this is the directly follows relationship that we create. Note that there are 16 traces. So from the start node, there is an arc with frequency 16, and everything starts with A. So these 16 cases all start with activity A. In the end, we always end with E, and so we also see the number 16 there. If you look, for example, at the connection between A and B, then we see that that is happening 10 times for the first trace. If we, for example, look at this connection between A and D, that is happening only once, etc., etc. Note in this example, every activity is happening only once in every single execution of the process. But if there are loops, of course, multiple things could be possible. This also shows immediately that that directly follows graphs are typically underfitting, not very precise, because here this looping structure between B and C suggests that it is possible to do A, B, C, B, C, B, C, E. Well, these things are possible according to the model, but we did not witness it in reality. And this is exactly why we need more sophisticated techniques. So if we take the example also used earlier, where we are creating pizzas, where we start with the pizza base. In the end, we end with cleaning the kitchen. In between, we can add toppings, and only if all three toppings are present, we eat the pizza. If we have data like that, and we create a directly follows graph based on this, then this is basically summarizing the execution of 2,000 executions of this process. Note that the first trace happened over 400 times. Yeah, so altogether are 2,000 cases. So this was using the Dataware Heuristic Miner plugin developed by Felix Manhart. This is the directly follows graph created by the software of Sander Leemans. And if you have such visualizations, you often can show frequencies, you can show times, but you can also animate the process on top of this. And this is actually very simple, because a particular case at any point in time is in an activity or is on its way from one activity to the next activity. This can be visualized relatively easily. So if you look at Celonis, the same concepts apply. So what you see here on the left hand side is a directly follows graph showing the frequencies. It's exactly the same as what you saw earlier in the different PROM plugins. You can animate it, and of course you can also look at, for example, the average time between one activity and the next activity. And here, the thicker the lines are, the more time is being spent of traveling from one activity to another activity. So the example that I just showed was very simple. We can also take a look at slightly more realistic data, although this is still relatively small and simple. So we look at a purchase to pay data set. So this is, let's say, the input side of an organization where one needs to procure, let's say, products. In this small data set, we have less than 3,000 cases, 16,000 events. But what we see is that there are already almost 700 different executions of this simple process. There are 24 unique activities. So this is simple, but if we create a directly follows graph, it looks like this. And so this is using one of the PROM plugins, but independent of what software you use, it will always look like this. And so we can zoom in to parts and we see that some of the connections are happening only once. We can also look at the directly follows visual miner that I mentioned earlier, and again we can zoom in, and again we see, let's say, exactly the same connections, and sometimes they are very infrequent. We can also look in Celonis, and although the layouting is different, the directly follows graph that you see is exactly the same. And we can zoom in to see, let's say, how often one activity is followed by another activity, and how long it takes to go from one activity directly to the next one. So this is probably not very helpful. Of course, it makes people aware of, let's say, that things are not as simple as they think they are. However, to really be able to interpret and to work with these models, you often want to simplify them. And for that, we are using filtering. What I will tell about filtering, we can apply it to directly follows graph, but we can also apply it to the techniques that I will talk about later. So the alpha algorithm and the inductive mining approach. So of the types of filtering, there are three types of filtering that I would like to discuss. Activity-based filtering, that is basically projecting away the activities that are infrequent. So we rank the activities and then remove the activities that are not so frequent. What is important is that we are completely removing these activities from our data. After removing activities, it may be that we introduce new directly follows relationships. So activity-based filtering has a clear effect on the number of activities that we see. If you look at variant-based filtering, it works differently. We are not removing activities, but we are basically removing traces. And we first rank all the traces based on the frequency. And so there may be many cases that follow exactly the same trace. These traces we keep, and the ones that are unique or that happen just a few times, these are the traces that we may remove. So with activity-based filtering, we are simply removing the events that correspond to low-frequent activities. With variant-based filtering, we are moving cases completely, right? And that may result in also removing activities, but the interpretation is that we remove cases. ARC-based filtering, which I do not recommend, is if the model is still too complex and you simply want to remove the spaghetti-ness, you may simply remove the ARCs that have a lower frequency. This is not recommended because the interpretation is not so predictable and not so clear. If you do this, you will see that if you have an activity that happens a certain number of times, that these numbers do not add up anymore if we look at what comes in and what goes out. Because by ARC-based filtering, we are cutting away certain paths. So the number of times, let's say a case enters the activity and the number of times a case exits the activity is no longer the same. So this is an example of activity-based filtering using the data set that I illustrated earlier. So if we look at the top seven activities, we can already see that the model becomes much simpler. So here you see the like one of the many filtering plugins in Prom to do that. This is if you do exactly the same in Celonis. So I'm selecting the activities that I want to keep. I do that based on frequency, and this is the model that remains. In principle, the result is exactly the same. In Celonis, it's also very easy to select, let's say, cases based on the frequency of the corresponding variant. So here I selected just the most frequent variant. So in total, there are 655 variants. But I select the most frequent one. There are 210 cases, and they correspond to approximately 8%. So 8% is covered by this single sequence. And then we can, let's say, add other variants if we want. So here we are looking at the top five variants. What you now see is that we are covering five of the 655 variants, but these already account for 24% of the cases. So we can see that data often follows a Pareto principle, that the few variants already cover a large part of the data that we look at. If we extend it from 5 to 10, we can see that we are already covering 35%. And you can see by adding variants, the process model, of course, becomes more complicated. If we add all 655 variants, of course, we have, again, the original directly follows graph. So that's what I did here, where we are covering 100% of the cases. And this model is exactly the same as the one that we started with. So I've showed to you how you can do activity-based filtering and variant-based filtering. One can also do ARC-based filtering, but that's something that I do not recommend. Therefore, I'm not showing that. So what are now the challenges of process discovery? First of all, and we have already seen that, we start with an example that did not have any repetitions in it, but we create a directly follows graph, and the model already starts generalizing the DFG, showing that there are certain loops, but the loops have never happened in reality. This shows that if you go from data to a representation, of course we would like to generalize, but we do not want to generalize too much. There is a challenge of taking data, mapping it onto a representation that at the same time is not overfitting the data, simply summarizing what we have seen. And we also do not want models that start to generalize too much, that suggest behaviors that are very far away from anything that we have ever seen in the data. So this is incredibly difficult. And if we have a model with a loop, like the example that I just mentioned, we immediately have infinitely many possible traces. At the same time, in our input data, we always have a finite number of traces that we have been observing. And so there is always a gap between what we see in the model and what we see in the log. It's also what we want. Also, and that's of course related, the event log just shows examples. Yeah, so we see a sample, and if we are collecting data for 1 week and later we collect data for another week, even if it's the same process and the same process is in steady state, it may be that the two event logs are very different if you look at it at the level of individual traces. As also, it also immediately shows that if something does not happen in 1 week, it does not mean it can never happen. It was just not in our sample. We also do not have any negative information. If you think of process discovery as a classification problem, which are the traces that are possible and which are the traces that are impossible? If you view it as a classification problem, you are only able to observe the positive examples, but you are never able to see the negative examples. So you cannot simply turn this into a standard classification problem. It doesn't work. We only have positive examples, and they are typically a few of many possible executions. And so we cannot think of this in terms of precision and recall. And I will try to visualize the problem, let's say, using a Venn diagram. So let's just assume that in this space we are looking at all possible behaviors. Think about a behavior as a trace, so a sequence of activities. So every dot in this oval is corresponding to a possible execution of the process, a sequence of activities. So this is what is possible in the process if we would observe it, let's say, infinitely long. Then there are the examples that we happen to see in the event log. And so these are the things that have happened in the period that we observed the process. And it's very important to realize that these are just examples. Then we have the process model. So the process model has semantics, and these semantics basically define what are the traces that are possible. So if we have a loop in the model, then immediately we have infinitely many possible traces. So we see already that there should be, that there's always going to be a disconnect between the event log and the model that we have seen, for two reasons. The model will generalize and will introduce things like loops, and it also should introduce loops. But at the same time, that leads to the situation that we can never really observe that in the event log. Also, the event log contains just examples, and we cannot assume that things that we have not observed are impossible. So if we just look at the event log and we know that this is problematic, then at best we can say, okay, these are the traces in the event log that do not fit into the model, and these are the traces that are in the event log that fit. And so here I'm showing the part which is bad, because we have observed behavior and the model is unable to describe it, and this is the part which is good because it was in our example data and it was also allowed by the model. But we immediately see the problem that we are just seeing a small part of the entire space. Also, this shows that if we choose a process model that allows for any behavior, it will always pass this test, because anything in the event log will fit into such a model that is too general. So there are many. So what we ideally would like to see is, okay, what is the part where model and the real process are overlapping? And we know that this is bad, because that is corresponding to behavior that is possible in the real process but not covered by the model. And we also know that we do not like to see this, because this would be behavior that is possible according to the to the model, but is not possible in the real process. So intuitively, we would like to have an overlap which is as big as possible, but we know that we cannot really test this. The only thing that we have is this sample data. Because of these challenges, it is not so easy to define quality measures. However, in literature, there is consensus that there are four dimensions, and these four dimensions can be quantified. How they are quantified, there are multiple ways to do that, and because of the challenges that I just mentioned, there are also multiple design choices possible. The first approximation of quality is, let's say, replay fitness, and this is the one that is easiest to understand. So this is the fraction of traces that we have observed in the log that are also possible according to the model. Note that it sounds very simple, but you also need to, for example, there are measures that would say, okay, a trace fits or does not fit, like a 0-1 outcome, true or false. However, if you look at a long trace, for example, of 50 activities, and suppose that it almost fits, so 49 of the events fit perfectly in the model, but there was this one event that did not fit, do you say that the whole trace doesn't fit, or do you want to say, okay, this is a trace that fits up to, let's say, 95% or something like that? So also here, multiple variations are possible. And if you go to the other dimensions, there are even more degrees of freedom. Precision looks at the reverse. So it tries to introduce a penalty for models that are too general, that contain behavior or allow for behavior that is very far away from what we have defined in the event log. Also there are multiple, let's say, ways to define that. The third dimension is simplicity, so that is Occam's razor. So if there is a simple model explaining the event data, or there is a complicated model, we would like to prefer to go for the simpler model. If there is a simple explanation, it is more reliable to take this one rather than a very complicated explanation that is less likely to hold. And last but not least is the notion of generalization. So these are metrics that work on a log and a model. These are not measures that work on algorithms. So if we talk about the discovery algorithm, we can, for example, do cross-validation, like for example, k-fold cross-validation. If you look at a model, you cannot do that. You have simply observed an event log, and you have a model, and you need to make a statement on the relationship between model and log, not so much about the algorithm used to produce it. And then you need to have a notion like generalization. And generalization basically looks at the following problem. Suppose that you observe a process up to a certain point in time. You create a model for it. What is the likelihood that new observations, so new traces, will actually fit into the model? So it's talking about unseen data. And that, of course, makes it very, very tricky and very difficult. Part of the challenges that we see here are created by the fact that in our data we have frequencies, and so we see how often certain paths have been taken. However, if we look at traditional process models like PetriNets, directly follows graphs, process trees, BPMN models, etc., we do not make any statements about the likelihood of paths. If you add probabilities to your process model, it becomes much easier and much more direct to define these things. And that's why I'm adding here a pointer to our work on stochastic conformance checking, which is basically making many of these, let's say, complications much easier, because we can talk about likelihoods rather than frequencies on the log side and true-false statements on the model side, because we can turn everything into probabilities and have a much more reliable comparison. But this topic goes more into conformance checking, and in this lecture we are focusing on discovery. So what we seen so far? We have seen that, okay, there is this baseline discovery technique to produce directly follows graphs described in two lines of mathematics. Then we briefly spoke about filtering, how you can seamlessly make these models more simpler by leaving out activities and process variants. Then we elaborated a bit on the challenges and how to measure quality. So let's now go into to more sophisticated discovery techniques. The basic idea of bottom-up discovery, and I'm explaining it here in terms of a Petri net, but you can think of any other representation, is that you start from the situation where anything is possible. So you have an event log, you know the activities that appear in the event log, you just list them, and your initial model is the model without any constraints. So you're basically saying any of these activities can happen in any order and as many times as is needed. So if we start with the model like that, we know that our replay fitness will be perfect, because any trace that we have observed will perfectly fit into this model. But the model is also very imprecise, because it will allow for many behaviors that are not possible in reality. And so, for example, this model allows people to eat the pizza that has not been produced at all. So that's bottom-up discovery. But it's important that you realize that Petri nets in nature are declarative. And starting from a Petri net without constraints, we can add places to specify these constraints. So for example, if we add a place with one input token like this, we are basically restricting the number of times that we execute BI to one. If we then also say, okay, in the final marking, this should be empty, then we have added the constraint, BI should be executed precisely one to reach the end. We can also add a place at the very end. And if we now say, okay, in our initial marking, there should be a token in the input place, and in our final marking, there should be a token in the sync place, the output place, then we are again specifying, okay, CK should happen precisely once. So if you look at this model, we are specifying, okay, BI should happen once and CK should happen once, and initially there is a token in the input place of BI, and at the end the output place of clean kitchen CK should be empty. And now we can incrementally add more constraints. So if we add a place here, and in the first lecture I explained the semantics of Petri nets, but just to repeat it, a transition in a Petri net is enabled if each of its input places contains at least one token. If it is enabled, it can occur. We often call that firing, and it consumes a token from each of the input places and produces a token for each of the output places. If on top of that we have the requirement, okay, in the beginning we start with one token in the input place, and in the end we end with one token in the sync place, we know that this place is empty at the beginning and should also be empty at the end. So what if we look at this local constraint, just this place in isolation, it is basically saying that at the end it should be empty, so the number of executions of BI should be exactly the same as the number of executions of CB. Moreover, at any point in time, the number of executions of BI should be at least the number of executions of CB that is indicated here. If this would not be the case, then there would be situations where we already create a pizza base before we have bought the ingredients. And in the process, we only saw that BI was followed by CB. So this is one constraint. Please bear in mind, the first row corresponds to the observation that at the end the place should be empty. So the number of executions of buy ingredients should be equal to the number of executions of create pizza base. Moreover, we cannot have any negative number of tokens in the places. So at any point in time, bi should be at least cb. Let's now look at the place connecting eat pizza and clean kitchen, and we see exactly the same pattern. Yeah, so because it's not the initial place and it's not the final place, we know that the number of times that we eat the pizza should be exactly the same to the number of times that we clean the kitchen. And we can never clean the kitchen before we have eaten the pizza. And that's why we have this constraint. There's another one. The connection between bake in oven and eat pizza. And it's exactly the same as before. Here we have a more interesting case. And that is the place connecting CB as an input transition to add salami and add mushrooms. And now what we see is that the number of times that CB is executed is equal to the sum of the number of times that add salami and add mushrooms is executed. And so in other words, there is a choice. This place should be empty at the end, and therefore we have this equality. While doing this, while the process is executing, it can never be that we already add salami or we add mushrooms before we have created the pizza base. That is reflected by the constraint that you see here. You can also look at, let's say, a place with multiple ingoing arcs and one outgoing arc. And now we see, let's say, the converse. So the number of times that AS is executed plus the number of times that AM is executed at the end should be equal to the number of times that we have baked the pizza in the oven. Moreover, during the execution of the process, we cannot have a negative number of tokens on the input place of BO. So therefore, AS plus AM should be at least BO. And in the end, it is exactly the same. Here I show some more places, but given what I explained before, this should be completely clear. So what I've showed you is that we can add these places, look at them as local constraints, and by just add constraints based on the data that we have seen, we get an end-to-end process model. What is important to note, and that's also mentioned on this slide, is that any process model with a subset of places was already an accepting PetriNet. So we have seen many, we have incrementally added constraints, but in every step we already had a process model. And bottom-up process discovery tries to do exactly this. So let's now get a bit into more detail to be able to also reason precisely about the alpha algorithm. So what I've explained intuitively already in the first lecture and also just now when explaining again PetriNets in a bottom-up way is we are looking at accepting PetriNets. And in an accepting PetriNet, we have an initial marking and a final marking. And we are looking at executions of this process model, which start in the initial marking and end in the final marking. And here, there are four examples of accepting PetriNets, where for every PetriNet, we have the network structure, but we are also indicating the initial and the final place. Yeah, so if we, for example, take a look at model C, in the initial marking, there is a token in P1 and P2, in the final marking, there should be a token in P4 and P5. And any execution of the process starting in this initial model, leading up to this final marking, is a possible execution according to this process model. Transitions are labeled. That means that in principle, we can also have transitions, multiple transitions that have the same name. You can see that in example D, where we have two transitions labeled A, T1 and T3. It can also be that we have transitions that are silent. So these often correspond to things like skipping. So these are things where we do not expect to see a corresponding activity in the event log. So let us walk through these examples and then also look at the language. And so what I've explained at the beginning, any model has semantics, and these semantics are expressed in a set of traces, and every trace is a sequence of activities. So if you look at this model, it is fairly simple. So we always start by executing A. After A, there is a token in P2 and P3, and all three transitions are enabled. If D happens, we go immediately to E. If B happens, then the next step will always be C, followed by E. If we do C, then this is always followed by B, followed by E. So we have three possible executions, and these are the ones that you see here. So this is just to show, given an accepting PetriNet, we can define a language. This model, from a structural point of view, looks almost the same, but the arcs connected to D have been reversed. So now we have introduced a loop. In the beginning, after doing A, we always do B and C in any order. And after doing that, we can do E and stop, or we do D. And if we do D, we go back to the situation where we have a marking state of the PetriNet with the token in P2 and P3. And again, we can execute B and C in any order, and we can repeat this as many times as we want. So here, the language corresponds to, let's say, the shortest execution, which is A, B, C, E, or A, C, B, E, or longer executions where we go through this loop. So for example, A, B, C, D, and after executing D, we are again in the situation where we can perform B and C in any order. And it always ends with an E. So now the models get, let's say, a bit more, let's say, weird, but I'm showing you these, let's say, strangely looking process models to make sure that you fully understand the semantics. So this is a PetriNet which in the initial state has two marked places, P1 and P2. In the final state, there should be a token in P4 and P5. And the language is defined by all executions of this process model going from this initial marking to this final marking where just P4 and P5 are marked. And if you look at this, what are all the executions possible? These are these four traces that you see here. So let's, for example, take a look at the first one. So we can do A, followed by B, followed by D, and then indeed there is a token in P4 and P5. It's also possible to, for example, first do C, then there is a token in P4 and P3. We execute T4, and then we end up in D. Yeah, so that was the execution CD. It's also possible that we have multiple transitions with the same label. So T1 and T3 have both the label A. Or we can have transitions that are silent, so they don't have a label. Or if they have a label, we often call that label tau. We also call these tau transitions. And given this model, these are possible executions. And so for example, if you look at the first one, we always start by executing A. And after executing A, we can do B and A, followed by the silent activity. But we do not see the execution of the silent activity. It's also possible to first do T1, then T3. Yeah, so these correspond to two executions of A by different transitions, then do a B, and then again we have the silent step to go to the end. Or we go through the loop by executing T4, but we do not see T4 in these traces. So I hope that this gives a good basis to be able to reason about the behavior of process models. I'm explaining this in a lot of detail in terms of PetriNets, but all of these concepts apply also to process trees and BPMN models, of course. So if you look at accepting PetriNets, there are powerful analysis techniques available. We can map, let's say, relevant subsets of BPMN and process trees onto this notation. So that is a way to give semantics to, for example, BPMN models. So it is very difficult to describe the semantics of a BPMN model from scratch, but by mapping it onto Petri nets that already have these semantics, the meaning becomes clear. Petri nets are also declarative in nature. You should think of places as constraints. And what we have also seen at the end are very strange structures possible, where you have initial and final markings with multiple tokens, or you can have transitions that are silent, or multiple transitions that have the same label. So this is much broader than you may realize, making it possible to express all the behaviors that we need in the context of process mining. Okay, finally, I can show you the alpha algorithm. And the good news is that it can be expressed in 8 lines of mathematics that you see here. But we will need to take some time to clearly explain what we see in these 8 lines. Note that the definition that I'm using here is slightly different compared to the original net, and that is to unify the notation better and to also be slightly more general. So the original alpha algorithm has some known limitations, and one of the known limitations is that if you have an activity that happens at the beginning of the process, it can never happen in the middle. Or if there is an activity that should happen at the end of the process, it can also not happen in the middle. So this contains like a trivial extension able to handle this thing. But the basic reason for using this notation is not to make it more general, but to show that given a directly follows graph, as I have explained it before, with the start and end node, can be turned into a Petri net. And so whatever tool you use to create directly follows graphs, you can take these directly follow graphs and use the alpha algorithm to turn them into, let's say, Petri nets. This also shows that we can do all the filtering. So if there are certain infrequent behaviors that we do not want to see, we should do that before when creating the directly follows graph. Given a directly follows graph, the algorithm is completely deterministic in producing a Petri net. So one of the things that I would like to emphasize is that A is the set of activities that we have seen in the log. A prime is the set of activities that we have seen in the log plus the special start and end activity. That is something that I would like to point out. Also, given a directly follows graph, we can talk about things like the arrow relationship that basically says that A can be directly followed by 2, by A1 can be directly followed by A2, but not the other way around. And so the arrow notation is the directly follows relation happening in only one direction. And so A1 can be followed by A2, but A2 cannot be followed by A1. That's the notation that we are using here. We have this notation that is basically stating that we have two activities, A1 and A2, that cannot follow each other. Note that if we have the directly follows graph, we have exactly this information. This is, showing again short reminder of something that we have seen earlier. Given an event log, we can create a directly follows graph using these two lines of mathematics, where the start and end node are added to the model. And such a directly follows graph contains all the information that we need to apply the alpha algorithm. This is repeating a bit what I said earlier, but now I highlight the things that you should note. And so A1 arrow A2 means that A1 is connected to A2 in the DFG, so it can be directly followed, but not the other way around. And so it's a one-directional arc. Then we have the notation that A1 and A2 never follow each other in any direction, and that means that they are disconnected in the DFG. And so This shows that we can read this information immediately from the DFG. Then we have A and A prime, and A prime includes the special start and end, which was not in the original data. What you will see in the algorithm, we just use these symbols. And so we can derive that from a directly follows graph, but we can now ignore all other aspects, and we can just focus on these three elements. You can see that in the first step of the algorithm, which is immediately also the most important step. So in the first step, we create so-called candidate places. And a candidate place is represented by a set of input activities and a set of output activities. And so A1 is what is the input for a place, and A2 is what is what are the activities that are consuming things from a place. Note that I'm using the word activity and transition in the alpha algorithm, because there are no silent transitions, there are not multiple transitions that have the same name. There is a one-to-one correspondence between activity and transition. So I can simply talk about things as if they are transitions, or I can also see them as activities. It's exactly the same. So A1 arrow A2 means that the connection is in one direction but not the other direction. So in the candidate places, these are, let's say, pairs of sets of places where the sets are non-empty. They are taken from A prime, so they include the special start and end node. And we have the requirement that A1 should be in this arrow connection to A2, where A1 and A2 are arbitrary elements of the set capital A1 and capital A2. So that should happen. So between A1 and A2, there can be just this arrow relationship. Between the elements of A1, things can never follow each other. So for every A1 and A2 element of A1, they can never be in a directly follows relationship in any direction. And the same applies to A2. So if we try to visualize what I just said in words, we are looking at this situation where we have a set A1 that is not empty and a set A2 that is not empty. These include activities and may include the special start and end node in the directly follows graph. This requirement that we have here says that any element in A1 should be in this arrow relationship with any other element in A2. So if we take A and D as an example, after A, I should be able to do D, and that should happen at least once in the data, but in the data, we never see D followed by A. This requirement is stating that within A1, things can never follow each other, so we never see A followed by B or B followed by C. If we look at our DFG, these are connections that are not non-existent. What's important to note is that A can also not follow itself. So if you look at this, let's say, logical constraint, it could be the case that A1 and A2 are actually the same, and they can never follow each other. So also, A cannot be in a so-called self loop, following itself. The same applies for the A2 set. So in A2, all the activities should never follow each other. And so D cannot be followed by D, E cannot be followed by E, D cannot be followed by E, and E cannot be followed by D. So if these requirements are met, then the pair A1, A2 is a candidate place. And so this is a very long explanation, but I hope it is clear to you. So, how should you think about these candidate places? We are already using the word place, but you should think of it as a place connecting the transitions in A1 with the transitions in A2. And now you also see why we have these requirements. And so it is logical when you look at this model that A can be followed by E, but E cannot be followed by A. etc. So also, if A would be followed by B, that would mean that there would be two tokens in this place. So if we assume that this place never contains multiple tokens, note we are looking at one case in isolation, this makes perfect sense. So these are candidates, but we have the following problem, that if we remove an activity in A1 or we remove an activity in A2, exactly the same requirements are satisfied. As long as A1 is not empty and A2 is not empty, we can take any subset, and it is guaranteed that all of these requirements are still valid. So visually, if we have this, then we also know, okay, if we remove E, then we know that we still have this connection, so we meet all the requirements. If we remove C, then we are in this situation, and we know that we meet all the requirements. So given this, there are many candidate places that we are all generating in this first step. So just to show that this is problematic, so if this would be a candidate place, then there would be actually 20 smaller ones. And they are listed here. And so also there is the candidate consisting of just A and B, or just C and E, etc., etc. And so there are many candidate places, and this would of course lead to an explosion. So this would mean that these transitions A, B, and C are not connected through one place with D and E, but there would actually be 20 places. That is the reason why in step 2 we only look at maximal places. So we start with our candidates from step 1, and we add the requirement that there cannot be any candidate places that are strictly larger. And so this is logically formulated like this. So if we take A1, A2 as a candidate, there cannot be an other candidate such that the candidate has at least many activities on one side, at least as many activities on the other side. If that is the case, then A1, comma A2 should be equal to A1 prime and A2 prime. And so this is formulated like this in mathematical terms. You can also interpret this as it is impossible to add another activity on the left-hand side or to add an activity on the right-hand side in such a way that all the properties are still maintained. And so that's why we say we only look at maximal candidates. They cannot be extended while still satisfying the requirements that we formulated for step 1. So in step 2, we prune the set of candidates to a much smaller set, and these are the places that we add. So the rest of the algorithm, so all the action is in the first two steps, the rest is just bookkeeping. And so in step 3, we basically say that every candidate that survives step 2, that was selected, is turned into a place, and the place is named after its input transitions and output transitions. We also have the initial place and the final place. Then we have the set of transitions. Transitions are labeled with the activity. Here are the arcs. And the arcs are basically encoding the connections that are already, let's say, in the name of the place. And so if we look at the place P A1, A2, it has input transitions, and all of these input transitions are in the set A1. If we look at P A1, A2, and we look at all the transitions in set A2, then they should all be connected. That is stated here. And so this is taking care of the input and the output. And of course, so note that in our set A prime, there is also the start and the end. So we have a start transition and an end transition. And the start transition has only one input place, and that is this P start place. The end transition just has one output place, and this is this P with the box notation. So this allows us to say that the initial marking is the marking with just the token in this place, and the final marking is just the marking with just the token in this place, pend. Transitions are labeled based on the corresponding labeling function. Note that the initial and final transitions are not labeled because this is an element of A. And now we have a discovery algorithm because we have said, okay, what is the set of places? What is the set of transitions? What are the arcs and what are the labels? What is the initial marking? What is the final marking? So we fully defined in a formal way the discovered accepting PetriNet. So this shows that this example, that this technique, given a directly follows graph, we can always produce a corresponding PetriNet. Here is our, let's say, very simple running example. So based on this log, we create this directly follows graph. This directly follows graph, even if we would remove all the frequencies, contains all the information that we need to first produce the candidates and then prune the candidates by selecting just the maximal ones. And you can see that the candidate set is bigger than the set of places selected in the end. If you look at this example, I can also, let's say, show a bit the mapping, but hopefully this is all clear. And so this is the place which is connecting the start activity to activity A. This is the place with one input transition, transition A, connected to two output transitions B and D. Note, we are using a labeled PetriNet, so we have like the start transition in the beginning, which does not have a label, it's invisible, an invisible transition at the very end, and all the other transitions have the label corresponding to the things that we have seen in the event log. And so this shows a one-to-one mapping between the places and the steps of the algorithm. This looks very busy because we are, showing the formal names like transition TA did this place name, and we can simply suppress it and we get a very clean model. So this is the, given this log, the alpha algorithm produces this model. Note that we have this special start transition at the end and this special start transition both at the beginning and the end, and we can suppress them in the situation that our initial activities are not happening in the middle and that our final activities, the activities that happen at the very end, put the token in this end place, that they do not happen somewhere in the middle of the process. And so if this is the case, then we can suppress these silent transitions and then we get something like this. This is not, and this is probably the PetriNet that you expected. This is not always the case. Yeah, so here's another example, and then I will show an example where we cannot suppress it. And so here again, given this event log, the alpha algorithm produces this model. Also here, the initial and the final transition can be suppressed. This is the example that is showing that sometimes you need to have this silent transition at the beginning and the end. So here I'm looking at a log where we always do A and B, but in arbitrary order. So we have 35 times A followed by B and 15 times B followed by A. In total, there are 50 cases. And if we do that, here we can see that we really need this start transition and this initial transition. If it would not be there, then both A and B would be connected to the same start place. And that would mean that there is a choice between A and B, rather than that they are executed concurrent. And this is because A does not just happen at the beginning, sometimes it happens at the end or in the middle. So what are the properties of this, very basic algorithm? It is scalable. You can produce a DFG extremely efficiently, and given the DFG, you have all the information to apply the alpha algorithm. I'm saying this under the assumption that the number of activities is significantly smaller than the number of events or cases. If you have process models that correspond to a subclass of free choice nets, there are the guarantee that you discover the correct model. However, if you look at processes that do not have this, that are not limited to this subclass of Petri nets, then you find problems. And well-known problems are, for example, handling of short loops, skipping, etc., etc. So some of these problems can be resolved fairly easily. For example, the problem with looping can be resolved very, very easily. Problems, for example, related to skipping or other things like long-term dependencies. So if in the beginning you execute A, then much later in the process you execute, for example, activity Z, but only if you do the A in the beginning. If you have such dependencies, then this algorithm cannot handle that. So without filtering, this approach is not very practical in real life settings, but it is very important to understand the alpha algorithm from a didactical point of view, because it cleanly shows you the essence of process discovery, also in situations where you are dealing with loops and concurrency, etc. So if you want to read up on this, you can look at this this well-known article that introduces the alpha algorithm. In this article, it is also clearly indicated under which circumstances you have the guarantee of correctness and under which circumstances it does not work. Yeah, so it's not intended as a really practical algorithm. Think of it as a, let's say, a foundational result that you need to understand if you are interested in the topic of process discovery. So here are some examples showing the problems. These problems were also already highlighted in the original paper. So here we can see that sometimes we do A, sometimes we do AB, and then we can execute an arbitrary number of C's in the middle between A and B. So if you apply the alpha algorithm, you get something like this. And what you see is that this model allows for the execution of A followed by B, and then there is a token here, and so we can execute this. Because C is disconnected, we also can execute this. It doesn't allow for the execution of just A, right? Because then we did not reach the final place. And so this first variant is not possible. All the other variants are possible. But there is the problem that C, because C is not connected to any place, C can also be executed before A or after B, which is unlikely given the data that we're looking at. So just some more examples. So here you see an example based on almost 1900 cases, let's say taken from the medical domain. There are almost 200 different ways of executing this process. And so you can see that some cases are executed frequently, others are unique. And this is the process model generated based on the alpha algorithm. So it's a discovery technique that works and is able to discover loops, concurrency, choices, etc. So let's now take a look at the second, let's say, more sophisticated discovery technique that we would like to explain, and that is the inductive mining approach. And so this is an example of top-down. The alpha algorithm was bottom-up. We first say anything is possible, and then we try to add constraints. The inductive mining approach uses a divide and conquer approach, where we try to recursively split the event log into smaller event logs until the point where the smaller event logs only contain a single activity. And so it's we start with the whole log, and then in every step we split the log into smaller logs until they become trivial. So the inductive mining approach is the most well-known approach that follows such a top-down strategy. So it's using process trees, and Why is it using process trees? Because process trees have this hierarchy that correspond to the recursion of the algorithm. However, the moment that you have a process tree, it's trivial to map it onto PetriNet's BPMN or whatever notation you would like to see. Just to refresh your knowledge of process trees, I already explained this in the first lecture, but I'm going to use exactly the same examples that I used to explain PetriNet. So this was the PetriNet that was modeling the situation where we have A at the beginning, E at the end, and in the middle we are either doing D or we are doing B and C in any order. The process tree captures exactly that. So we have a sequence of first A, at the end we have E, in the middle we execute this subtree, and this subtree represents a choice between just doing D or doing B and C in any order, parallel composition. So there are four types of operators, and here we see three of them. We see sequential composition, we see exclusive choice, and we see parallel composition. This is another process tree, it's corresponding to this PetriNet, where we have this loop involving D. Again, the sequence construct is exactly the same. We start with A and we end with E. In the middle, we are executing this redo loop. And the redo loop on the left-hand side, we are executing B and C concurrently, and so in any order. On the right-hand side, we are executing D. And remember that the redo loop says the following. We always start by executing the left branch, so the concurrent subtree. We always execute that subtree. And after we finished executing that subtree, we either stop and go to E, or we execute D. And if we execute D, so when we execute the left branch, then we after that we always go back to the right hand side. So we can execute left and then stop, or we can execute the left child, then the right child, and then again the left child and chop, and we can go through this loop multiple times. This is another example showing that in a process tree, in principle, we can have multiple activities with the same label. We can also have like silent activities, just like the tau steps in the PetriNet. So what you see here is that we always start by executing A. After that, we go into this part, where we can execute A and B concurrently as many times as we want. If we execute this tau, that means that we are going to execute A and B again. So this was a short refresher of process trees, and now we can explain the algorithm. And so we are using a divide and conquer approach. We start with the whole event log and try to split it into smaller and smaller event logs. And in every step, we are getting logs that refer to subsets of activities. And so splitting is always based on activity labels. We always create the directly follows graph, and we try to cut it into different parts corresponding to sequential composition, exclusive choice, parallel composition, or this redo loop structure. And when we look at the DFG, we can see what of these operators may apply. So this is seminal work done together with Sander Lehmans in the context of his PhD thesis. And so it's also implemented in PROM, but also in tools like, for example, Celonis. So, because I'm going to split activities, I'm representing an event log in this way, where I can nicely color the different events. So again, this is a running example about creating pizzas. So we are using two-letter names to refer to the different activities. So for example, EP means eat pizza. What we do is that based on such an event log, we create a directly follows graph, and this is nothing new. This is what we have been doing already before. So using two lines of mathematics, we can describe how we go from the log to this directly Fallis graph. Here we are ignoring frequencies, but of course when you're doing filtering, you can use them to cut off certain branches. So if we look at the directly Fallis graph based on this data, and we look at it in a bit more detail, we see that we can cut it into different parts in such a way that the arrows always go from left to right. So we do not have any arrows that are going in the reverse direction. So this is one of the requirements of the sequence cut. So we should be able to partition our activities in such a way that the connections are always from left to right and not in the opposite direction. Yeah, so from any node here, I should be able to reach any of the node in the later stages. But if we look at the transitive closure, there is never the possibility to go back. So if we take this split, so this is a so-called sequence cut, we can color the activities that are in the different, let's say, subsets that we identify based on this. So in this example, we have one subset, another subset, then the third subset consists of four activities, and then there are again three singleton subsets, just containing one activity. And so this is a bit of an extreme situation, just to keep the example very small, but this is kind of unusual. Typically, you have multiple subsets that contain multiple activities. But this, in the simple scenario, we then color all the different events with the color of how we classified the activity. So we have the red activities, the yellow activities, etc. And note that there are four blue activities, and what we can immediately see, these are happening in the middle. If you look at this visualization, you also immediately see that indeed we just have connections from left to right, because the colors are clearly sorted. And so if there would be like somehow a blue activity somewhere at the end, right, we would know that it would violate this structure. So based on this coloring, we can already see that we can split the event log in different parts. Think of them as subsequences that are executed in using the sequence operator. So five of the projected event logs that we then get, so based on splitting this, we are creating an event log for every subset of activities. Then we get these subsets that all refer to just a single activity, which is a kind of exceptional situation. What you see here is that in the blue subset, sometimes it is skipped. If you look at the blue group, which was in the middle, that refers to four activities, and the corresponding event log looks like this. So after this first step, we have moved from one event log to these five event logs that we see here, plus this one, which is a bit more involved. So after the sequence operator, we basically split the behavior into different sublogs. And this is this divide and conquer approach that I was referring to earlier. So now we transform each of these sublogs again in a DFG. If they are not singletons yet. If they are singletons, we can immediately replace them by corresponding activities. So we see that in every row in our sublog, there is one execution of by ingredients. So we can convert that into an activity. So all of this is clear, except in the, let's say, sublog consisting just of events EP, we see that sometimes the EP event is missing. So we also have empty traces here. And that's why we model that as follows, that there is a choice between EP and not doing anything. So this should all be pretty easy. And so the only thing that remains is now the blue part. And so we have again another log, and we can create the corresponding directly Fallis graph. And so based on this log which just has four unique activities. This is directly follows graph that we see. And now if we analyze this structure, we see that we can no longer apply a sequence cut. There's no way that we can cut the set of activities in two subsets in such a way that arcs go only in one direction. Also note, if you take a closer look, you can see that AS and AM are not connected to each other. And the reason for that was that in the process that there was a choice between adding salami or adding mushrooms. And that's why they are not connected. So we cannot apply a sequence cut. If there is an exclusive cut, it would mean that we can that the activities are completely disconnected. They are not pointing to each other. That's also not the case. But we can apply a so-called parallel cut. And so we cut the RDFG into these parts where we have three subsets. And the requirement for such a parallel cut is that any activity in one of the parts separated is connected to any activity on the other side. And so for example, if we look at AC is in a directly follows relationship with all of the other activities in the other subset. If we look at it from AM, AM should be connected to all of the activities in the other subset, but it does not need to be connected to AS because it's in the same, let's say, partitioning. So we cannot split it here because of the missing connection between AS and AM and AM and AS. So if we apply the parallel cut, we can again color our event log in this way. Now we see that these are not executed in sequence, but are executed independent of each other. And if we look at the individual event logs, they look like this. So we have AC, and the log just consisting of AC. And what you see is that this is a so-called base case, because we just see AC activities, and they happen one or more times. We have the blue log, that is about adding tomato. It always happens exactly once. And then we have the red sublog, where we either execute AS, add salami, or we add mushrooms. So the first two are base cases. The third one is not, because we still have two activities. So these base cases, we can immediately replace them by singleton activities, or these small constructs, like here we see AC should happen at least once, and this is the corresponding construct in the process tree. Again, we always execute AC once, and using the tau, we can repeat this multiple times. So the only thing that remains is this sublog. It's very simple, but it still has two activities. So we built the directly follows graph. It looks like this. And now we can apply a so-called exclusive choice cut. And the requirement here is that things in the different parts are not connected. Yeah, so if there would be more activities and we split it in two, then there could be, let's say, connections within the different subparts, but between the different subparts, there cannot be any connection. So this allows us to cut it into two event logs that look like this and this. In these event logs, after we have split it in this way, AS and AM always happen exactly once. So we get this situation. We have a choice, because this was an exclusive choice cut. And then we below that we have base cases where there is just one activity involved, so we can immediately go to this model. So this is showing how, from an event log, using a divide and conquer approach, we have created such a process tree. And people are not used to seeing these types of representations, but it's completely trivial to map this onto a PetriNet, as we have seen before, or to map this onto a PPMN model. And note that the semantics is exactly the same. So what we see is that we can add cheese multiple times, we can skip eating the pizza, and we can either add salami or we can add mushrooms. If we look at the BPMN model, we see exactly the same. So we can go through this loop of adding cheese multiple times. We have the choice using the XOR gateways. So this is an XOR split, this is an XOR join, which represents the choice between adding salami and adding mushrooms. And here we have the possibility that we either eat pizza or we skip this step. So this shows that this really works. I was not very precise in listing the exact requirements. They are, written down in this chapter 2 of the handbook. And so this is describing in mathematics what the exact requirements are. And it goes too far to now explain this in a lot of detail, but hopefully you got the intuition, which makes it easier for you to read these formal definitions. So if I, briefly explain again what is the semantics of all the four cuts and what is the requirement. So we have a choice situation, an exclusive choice cut. If we can split our directly follows graphs in things that are completely disconnected. Of course, I'm leaving out the start and end note here. We have a sequence cut. If there is some part where we can begin, there's some part where we can end, and all the connections that we have are going in only one direction. So it's impossible to go back. Then there is a sequence cut. Parallel cut means that we can split it into different parts in such a way that there is a connection between any activity in one part and any activity in another part, but inside the same part of the DFG, not all connections need to be present. What is also important here is that we can also begin. So think of the artificial start node and the artificial end node as being outside of this. So we should be able to start in each of these parallel parts, and we should be able to end in each of these parallel parts. The most complicated construct, and you can also see that if you look at the formalization, because there are multiple rows needed to fully specify it, the redo loop cut situation cuts the process model in different parts, where all of the where the first one is special because it corresponds to the left hand side of the redo loop. All the parts that are on the right hand side, they are in an XOR situation. So you can think of this as an XOR, the same as we had here before. So we can focus on just one of them. And here the requirement is we always start in the top part. We also always end in the top part. And like all the end nodes of the top part are the beginning of these elements in the bottom part. And just think of this as one. And so all the ends here correspond to the starts here. Similarly, all the ends here correspond one to one to the starts that we have here. And so this is this memoryless property that if we go through the redo loop, we basically start as if we just went into the loop for the first time. And at the end, we always have the choice to stop or to go back, execute one of these subtrees, and then we start as if we didn't do anything yet, and we go again through this loop situation. So just for some examples, so here you see like a small fragment of a data set with almost 2,000 cases, almost 200 different variants, 8 unique activities. So this is what the corresponding directly follows graph look like. If we apply PROM and we apply the alpha algorithm, we get this. We have seen that before. If you use the inductive visual miner, so there is a process tree behind it, you don't see it when you see this nice visual representation, but it is using a BPMN style to show the process tree. And we can see that it captures exactly the behavior that we would like to see, and we can also see frequencies. So in blue, we see frequencies. In red, we see times in front of these activities. So there are different visualizations, and although you don't see it immediately, there is a process tree behind this example that looks like this. And different visualizations are possible of process trees. It could be really like a tree structure, or it could be BPMN or PetriNet-like. So if we map this onto an exaptic PetriNet, then it looks like this, which is in this example, just by coincidence, exactly the same as the alpha algorithm. The inductive mining algorithm is also supported by tools like Celonis. So this is the directly follows graph of the same data set in Celonis. We can also apply the inductive mining algorithm in Celonis, and what you see, the layout is different, but it's exactly the same process model that we have found earlier in Prol. And this is an illustration that this technique works nicely. Of course, as I stated before, the alpha algorithm doesn't really function well on real-life data, specifically if you did not filter it before. If you look at the inductive mining approach, it has been extended with all kinds of filtering approaches, and it really works well in let's say, real-life situations. So here you see a fragment of, let's say, one of these order handling processes that we have seen earlier. So the directly follows graph looks very spaghetti-like. If we look at the corresponding BPMN model, it is very, very elegant and very readable. So to summarize, inductive mining is a top-down approach. It has very nice properties. So the models that we get are always what we call sound, so they do not have any deadlocks, no live locks, or other types of problems. There are no disconnected parts, because it has this hierarchical structure mapped onto, for example, a BPMN model. It has many strong guarantees. And so one of the guarantees, if you want, it is able to completely reproduce the event log. And so that means that any trace that has been used as input to learn such a process model can be reproduced by the process model that comes out of it. And so if you want, you have the guarantee that fitness is equal to one. Of course, in many cases you don't want that. You want to focus on the mainstream behavior, and then you can apply sliders to filter the data. It has a good performance, because it's basically based on repeatedly producing directly follows graphs, which is relatively efficient. Under certain circumstances, there are also even stronger theoretical guarantees. So with some conditions, if you start with the process tree, you generate an event log from it, which is directly follows complete, then it is guaranteed that if you apply the inductive mining algorithm again, that you get a process tree that has exactly the same behavior as the process tree that you started with in the first place. And that's a kind of healthy property. By the way, that also applies to the alpha algorithm. If you start from a special class of processes, it is guaranteed that you are able to rediscover this process, the corresponding process model. However, there the assumptions are much stronger than in the context of inductive mining. Plus, you have the guarantee that if you want, your input data fits the model. And I think that is very important in many applications where people want to see all the behavior. So to conclude, in this lecture, we started with a baseline discovery technique where we are discovering a directly follows graph. This could be done in two lines of mathematics, and I have explained different types of filtering to simplify the directly follows graph by either taking out activities or taking out process variants. The directly follows graph has many limitations. So for example, if things do not happen in a fixed order, you immediately get loops. Yeah, so even if there are no repetitions in your data. Therefore, we need to have more sophisticated process discovery techniques. We explained the alpha algorithm as an example of a bottom-up discovery technique. So the alpha algorithm starts from the assumption, okay, there are no constraints, and then adds places to represent constraints that hold between subsets of activities. This could be done in 8 lines of mathematics. After that, we move to the more practical approach of inductive mining. I showed you the basic inductive mining algorithm. I showed you the formalization, that's approximately, let's say, 20 lines of mathematics. It's a bit more involved, but it has many guarantees. And like, for example, if you want it, it can reproduce the event log that you learned to train it. Although there are all of these techniques available and they also function well, specifically first exploring the data using DFGs and then applying inductive mining. And so that works very well in practice, but it is not a solved problem. And there are still ways, there's still research needed to further improve, let's say, these types of techniques. Also, today we are focusing very much on object-centric process mining, and what you can see is that we can discover so-called object-centric process models, again using techniques like inductive mining or DFGs or the alpha algorithm, etc., etc. So even if you don't see it directly, many of these algorithms are there in the background. This lecture was completely devoted to the first step of process mining, which is process discovery. Of course, this is just one of many possible process mining tasks. A logical next step is to look at conformance checking. But yeah, it's a very broad topic. Think of the connection between process mining and automation, for example, action flows. Or think about the connection between process mining and AI and machine learning when we are looking at predictive process mining. So if you want to learn more, I'm again, let's say, showing some websites that you can look at. I highly recommend to look at the website www.processmining.org. To see the other lectures that have been recorded in the Process Mining Summer School, I refer to the second URL. There is the IEEE Task Force on Process Mining. There are the tools that I used, PROM and Solonis. There are these websites that describe, for example, the XES standard and the standard for object-centric event logs. And at the bottom, you see my own website and the website of our group. To learn more, so this was a relatively short course, but you can go much deeper. So you can check out the Coursera course, Process Mining Data Science in Action, which has been taken by over 150,000 people. And you can take a look at a much more recent course, Process Mining from Theory to Execution, which has been taken by over 10,000 people. And there are also some courses in the pipeline. Last but not least, I'm showing you some covers of the book. And so Process Mining is the Process Mining Data Science in Action book is a great way to get started and to get a comprehensive overview of what are now the technical foundations of the field as a whole. If you want to see a more recent update and also a much broader update of the field, you can take a look at the Process Mining Handbook. In my lectures here, I presented chapter 1 and chapter 2, which serve as a basis for the rest. Enjoy the other lectures that have been recorded, and I hope you will be able to apply this in your daily work. Bye-bye.